So another week, we have two wonderful guest speakers today. You're going to love these guys. We have Avi Eisenberg and Joe Durkin from South Florida Distillers in Fort Lauderdale. It's Fort Lauderdale's oldest distillery. They will tell you more about that. And Joe is actually an alum of Rosen College. Yeah, graduated in 2012. Oh, yep. 2012, graduated from here. Okay, now the distiller at South Florida Distillers. So without further ado, they've got a lot of really interesting stuff to cover. You've got 10, you can actually have 11 different rums to taste today. So be mindful of that. Don't drink too much of them.
It's only 10:30 in the morning.
Yeah, but it's a good way to start a Monday. Hopefully you've all had breakfast. Yeah, if you don't, make sure you eat. If you haven't, make sure you eat those crackers. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Avi and Joe.
Good morning, everyone. How you doing?
Good.
I want to start off the class real quick with a little kind of test that I saw another rum distiller do. His name's Richard Seal. Give credit where credit's due. You have three samples to start, and I want you to independently taste them in order, and then we're going to discuss what they are. And I want to see how you guys do. I think you'll be intrigued by the results. So why don't you... Okay, let's take a look at it. So let me see some hands for what's in the first sample. I want to hear what it is. Someone. You can shout it out. You don't have to raise your hand. Anyone. You can be wrong. It's okay.
We got prizes. Is it?
Wrong.
Excellent. That is, I mean, everyone, that is amazing. Okay. So the first sample we have is Bacardi Rum, Bacardi Superior. That would have been in the second half of the class with the tasting, but we're just bringing it to the front. It's a white rum. We'll get into some of the details about how it's made towards the end. What about in the second tasting? Rum. What else? Lemon. Anyone else? Second sample is Stoli Vodka. Okay. You should have said it out loud. Again, there's no wrong answers. I'm fishing for, you know, some ideas here, right?
There are wrong answers. We just won't make.
We won't pay attention to those. So you have rum in the first sample, vodka in the second sample. And then the question now is, what's in the third sample? Jim?
Cachaca.
Anyone else?
What did it taste like?
Sweeter.
Yeah. Sweeter what? Oh, who said that?
Yeah. There you go. Sweeter vodka. Okay, so the point of this kind of experiment is to show you that, like, oftentimes, let's say with a product like Bacardi, it's processed to the point where it's somewhat difficult to distinguish from vodka. And in addition, if you take something like vodka that's fully processed and no flavor, you add a little bit of sugar back to it, it could easily be confused for rum. You know, you'd never know if you went to a restaurant and that's what they were using for rum. You'd totally think it was fine. And in fact, we've talked to a lot of people that have opened bars that don't have vodka at all. Because typically in vodka cocktails, you're adding a little bit of sugar in some form or fashion with simple syrup or something else, and they just use white rum instead to replace it and don't carry vodka at all. Well, let's move on. So some quick facts about rum. Rum is made from any byproduct or product from sugarcane. So that could range from sugarcane juice to molasses, and molasses has a full spectrum of different qualities from what they call like a first boil or a grade A, all the way down to like a blackstrap molasses. People do use blackstrap molasses to make rum, but it's also used for cattle feed, to give you an idea. Whereas, let's say with our rum, we use a grade A baking molasses. It's no different than like what Betty Crocker would use in a product, you know, out on that line. Or Joey likes to joke about the Keebler elves. It's like the same molasses that they would have that they would use.
But for real, Nabisco is actually buying this molasses. It's like that high.
Yeah, we buy our product directly from the sugar mills, so they deal with people who are way bigger than us. In addition to molasses, you can make rum out of any type of processed sugar, so your white sugar could be used. No flavor in making a rum out of white sugar, but in the end of the day, it is still considered rum. Brown sugar, which is white sugar with molasses added back to it. You can have something like turbinado or panela. Basically, any form of sugar coming from sugarcane makes rum. It's important to note that in the history of making a spirit based on a like a sugar plant, if you will, in Europe they used sugar beets to make what they called rum at the time. It's technically not rum. In the United States, it would be sugar beet spirit. It has to be distilled to no more than 95% alcohol. I don't actually believe there's a lower bound other than the fact it has to be bottled at 40% alcohol. So molasses is 50% sugar at minimum, depending on the grade. Your blackstrap molasses has about 50% sugar. In our molasses, so the grade A, the first boil, it's about 80% sugar. 79 to 80% sugar. We get a spec sheet with every batch. Very, very low ash content. Whereas blackstrap, because it's processed and boiled, there's a lot of ash that's concentrated from the process. And in fact, ash contributes to the flavor heavily when you do use blackstrap molasses. Rum can be produced anywhere in the world. In fact, it's, I believe, the most widely produced spirit just because sugarcane is abundant wherever it's growing. It grows like a weed, effectively.
Second best grass in the world.
So, but you know, they're making rum everywhere. United States, South America, like India is big on rum. China is starting to produce a lot of rum. It's very interesting. There's very, very, very little regulation. And the regulation differs a bit on the domestic produced stuff, the imported rum, and then actually there's two additional categories when it comes to rum in the United States. Beyond domestic and import, you also have Puerto Rican rum and rum from the U.S. Virgin Islands. Those are both two distinct categories, and we can talk about that in a little bit. So there's two main styles of rum production. You have your rum agricole and your rum industrial, or industrial rum. Rum agricole is made from sugarcane juice. So quite literally, you know, the tractors go out to the field. First, they burn the cane fields. I'm not sure if any of you have seen how cane harvesting works. But they burn the cane fields to get rid of all the leaves. And as soon as that fire goes out, literally, there's tractors and trucks lined up to harvest the cane, like, as the wind blows out the fire. From the time you cut the cane, there's an exponential decay into how much sugar can be extracted from the cane. Within, like, a 24 to 48 hour period, you could lose about half the juice if you don't press it. Between it seeping out, between the cane stalks themselves starting to ferment. So it's literally, they harvest it, they take it right to the mill, and they press it. And as a result of that, if you were to take like an airplane and fly around the sugarcane field, it's literally staged. Like they planted this cane the day before that cane, and so forth, so that when they harvest, it's just daily back to back, they just move across the fields. So you would take the sugarcane right to the mill and press it. And you get sugarcane juice. Has anyone ever had, it's called guarapo or sugarcane juice, like at a farmer's market or something like that? Yeah? So it has a very distinct taste, right? First of all, you'd notice it's kind of like a weird brownish, grayish color. It's really kind of hard to describe the color of it, but very, very distinct, like kind of pungent flavor to it. If you take that, it's actually the perfect condition to ferment. It has perfect amount of sugar with the perfect amount of water. If you were to just squeeze that and put that in a field, let's say, it would ferment naturally with wild yeast. And in fact, what you'll find is a lot of the Caribbean distillers use wild yeast that's just been like kind of breeding across their sugarcane fields for, you know, decades or 100 years or whatever the case may be. Second to the rum agricole, which is again produced from sugarcane juice, is everything else. So if you took that sugarcane juice and boiled it, out of that, you're going to get molasses. Out of that, you're going to get crystallized sugar and any of the other forms of sugar I mentioned before. That produces industrial rum. And it's, you know, in my opinion, it's super easy to remember. It's industrial rum because it came from an ingredient that was processed in some form or fashion. I believe everything up here except Clément and Leblanc were produced, is industrial rum, where the other two were produced from agricole. And I think you'll notice the difference in taste when we get to that. You guys have learned a little bit about distilling methods, right? So rum can be produced with either pot distilling, which is just a big pot with a column on top that's empty, and you're just boiling the vapors and condensing, or you can run a column still. In the rum world, there's two types of column stills. One would be where you have your fermented liquid on the base, you're boiling it, it's running through what are called plates or bubble caps, and every time it passes a layer, it gets more pure. And that would be the product that ends up being more like your 95% alcohol when it's distilled. But there's also another type of column still used in the rum world. It's a twin column still. And actually at the base of the still, all you're doing is injecting steam up one side. It goes through all these bubble plates, and at the top, you're dripping down fermented liquid. And as the fermented liquid drips down across the steam, there's an exchange of heat, the water drips back down, and only the alcohol is vaporized and continues going up. It produces a very traditional rum flavor. It does not, that second style of column still does not remove the same amount of, it doesn't purify it the same way like your craft column stills would of today. Something very interesting to note about rum, it's actually considered, what do they call it, the pure spirit, the noble spirit?
Noble
spirit. And they called it that because it is produced directly from a sugar source. Whereas if you're making something like whiskey, you have to take the grains, you have to boil it, run a mashing process to convert the starch into sugar, which leads to other fermented alcohol, which you don't want in your spirit. There are many different regions. Like we discussed, rum can be made all over the world, but by the nature of the cultures that were making it, it kind of fell into its own classification system. So you have your English-style rums, quite literally, these were from islands that were colonies of England, right? So you have Jamaica, Bermuda, Trinidad, Bahamas, Belize. As you can see on the slides, it says it makes a rich and pungent rum. Is anyone here like really into rum that would know stuff about Jamaican rum? You want to fill in the class? Nothing? No? Okay, so I'm going to teach you. So Jamaican rum is very interesting. They use, a lot of them use what's called a dunder pit, or if you're familiar in whiskey, they call it back setting. But essentially, when you ferment, you know, you take molasses and water, you mix it, you ferment it, you're essentially taking the sugar, converting it to alcohol, and then boiling that away. So you're left with a mixture of just a ton of nutrients, a little bit of alcohol left, maybe some sugar that didn't ferment into alcohol, and water. Now, you know, that's, in distilling, there's about a 90% waste factor. It's something that kind of is swept under the rug and no one really wants to talk about. If you think, you know, you're distilling 10,000 gallons a day and disposing of 9,000 gallons of waste liquid, that's, you know, people don't want to hear about that kind of stuff. So what they do in Jamaica, instead of dumping it into like a public sewer system for water processing to deal with, they cut these canals or pits or whatever form, shape you want to think, into the ground. Literally, they don't line it. It's just like a mud pit, and they fill it with dunder. Okay? Now, over time, parts of it evaporate. When, you know, when the liquid evaporates out, all it's doing is concentrating what's in the liquid to begin with. It has enough alcohol that bacteria can actually eat the alcohol and thrive. If you're familiar with kombucha, like you ferment tea and then bacteria takes over and converts the alcohol back into...
produces probiotics.
Yeah, it produces probiotics from the alcohol. So the same kind of thing goes on in these dunder pits. Quite literally, you have this pit of liquid that becomes encased in like a bacteria mold. It turns the inside into like the equivalent of like a vinegar, if you will. And then that, like a year later, might be tapped out and then siphoned into a next batch for fermenting. Yeah, we'll get to that in a second. So either it'll be added to the ferment or it'll be added back into the still for the round of boiling. And the acidic nature of what's going on in there adds, when you add that with alcohol, you produce esters. And then the esters contribute to the flavor of the Jamaican rum. So you, quite literally, there's nothing like Jamaican rum when it comes to flavor. Joey mentioned a goat head. True or not true is for you to decide, but there's been rumors and stories that different distilleries kickstart the bacterial growth in these dunder pits through different methods, one of which would be to literally throw a goat head into the pit and just kind of let it take over.
Rot.
You know, different from making beer, around distilling, bacteria is welcomed. You know, you go to some of these smaller distilleries and it's like, you know, it's in a hut outside. It's not like beer where it's like a super sanitary environment. Everything's perfectly cleaned every time. It's just not, it's not the same. So moving on, you have your Spanish style rum. So it's Cuba, Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, Panama, Guyana. Light and clean rum. Actually, what's very interesting to note about the Spanish style rum, and specifically Cuba and Puerto Rico, and we'll get to that in a second, is that it's very reminiscent of the rum that was produced in New England during the time of the Triangle of Trade. And that part, I think, was taken out of the presentation. But
and I think we did go into that earlier in the semester, didn't we, the Trade Triangle?
So during that time, there was rum being produced in the Caribbean, but New England, as it was facing, like, you know, it was going through an industrial revolution of sorts, they started producing rum in New England because they had pretty good metallurgy coming over from Europe. So they were able to make really big stills and kind of industrialize the process. But because they did that, they made it really clean and very light. Along the lines of Cuba and Puerto Rico, I wanted to bring out this. So this is our third lecture here, and the first time I mentioned this to the students, and the debate's still going on. So is anyone familiar with Havana Club? Has anyone ever had Cuban Havana Club rum? Yes? Anyone else? So if you were to go to the store today, any liquor store around here, you might find this in the store, Havana Club, Puerto Rican rum. This is produced by Bacardi. Okay, at the time when Cuba went to a dictatorship and the U.S. cut off diplomatic ties with Cuba, Bacardi was moved out of Cuba because the Cuban government was about to take control of their factory. The family moved from Cuba to Puerto Rico with U.S. assistance. In that deal, Bacardi got the trademark rights to use Havana Club in the United States because Cuba would never be able to sell Havana Club in the United States, and they were already making Havana Club. Now, the Cuban government still makes Havana Club, and it's distributed all over the world, except in the United States. Pernod Ricard is the supplier of this, except now we're discussing opening diplomatic ties with Cuba, which brings about a very interesting point, because now who owns the trademark on this? You know, when you're talking about a massive revenue stream for a country like Cuba, and the U.S. saying, well, we're going to open up diplomatic ties with you, but by the way, your number one export or one of your highest grossing exports, that can't come along because we fund Bacardi in one way or another through taxes, and they get to stay on the shelf. Yep. So it's very interesting. Havana Club, Bacardi does not have a trademark symbol on it, even though it is trademarked and owned by Bacardi, whereas Havana Club has a trademark symbol, but for everywhere except the United States. So just interesting to note, if you want to, after class, you could come take a look at the bottles. They are very close. They resemble each other pretty closely, in my opinion. Close enough that there is brand confusion, for sure. And that was done on purpose. Then, yes. Oh, there's no comparison. This brand, to be honest, Havana Club from Bacardi, is only recently being marketed. Like, they've made it for a long time, but it wasn't really pushed out anywhere. But because of all the talks with opening the diplomatic relations, they've put a whole marketing campaign behind it. It might as well be any other Bacardi product.
Like a Bacardi Gold, they added a little more color to it to make it darker and blonde. Like, it has no comparison. The 7 years actually, like, super quality product. I got it from have sushi at this little hole-in-the-wall place, and this pilot came in, and he traded me a bottle of Fuego for this. I don't have any left for you guys, because it was that good.
And then the French-style rums, real quick. Haiti, Martinique, Guadeloupe, and the French West Indies. These islands make your rum agricole. As we mentioned, that's made from sugarcane juice. Now, what's important to note about a lot of these islands, no different than the French wine, it falls under DOC. So you can't just make rum agricole in Haiti. It doesn't work that way. It's a governed product. You're only allowed to produce so much under a certain name, and that's it. Again, very different in taste, and you'll see that when we get to the tastings. Different rum styles, we can go through these real quick. Your white rums, obviously they are clear, very light flavors, typically fruity, citrusy, that kind of thing. It says usually made in a continuous still. I'd say depends on where it's coming from. Bacardi, for sure, is in a continuous still. White rum may or may not be aged. Our white rum is no age, no filter, whereas Bacardi is aged and then triple filtered after the fact, so it becomes clear again, but it maintains some of like the vanilla notes, let's say, from the barrels. You have your golden or amber rum. And by the way, on here, the only things that actually count as categories legally are white rum, or it's just rum, aged rum, and flavored rum. Spiced falls under flavored when it comes to legal classification. Gold falls under rum, no different than white rum if it doesn't have an age statement. Golden rums, slightly darker in color. This could be due to aging. It could be due to oak chips. It could be due to added sugar, caramel. There's something called spirit caramel that a lot of distilleries use. We don't, but people do. It can be used to stabilize color over large batches, just to make sure that your customers have a consistent product that they're buying. Your dark rums, here it says rich, buttery, and caramel flavor. Again, the caramel flavor is usually coming from some sort of sugar being added back, and you'll taste that in Goslings. It could be caramel, it could be sugar, it could be spirit caramel. Dark rums don't get that dark from aging. There are some rums out there where they do get really dark. I'm not sure I believe it's all from aging. They may tell you that's the case, and I'd love to debate that with them. Age-dated rums, so when we go and we make our, when you make a rum that's aged, there's certain, like, there's rules around it. It can't be flavored at all. It's literally white rum put into barrels and it's sitting there. Normally you're listing, for us it was aged at least 12 months. I don't want to put 1 year, like that doesn't seem that like big, but at the same time, I don't want to like create any false advertising around the age. I think in the rum category and a lot of the spirits categories, there's contention around how you list the age of a product. And a lot of it comes from the fact that your big corporations, like the guys that are just about the numbers, want it to seem like it's a super old product and try and sell you something that is not true. Whereas like we get stuck on the opposite end of that spectrum where I want you to know nothing but the truth about our product. And because of that kind of debate, you know, the rules around the ages, you know, that comes out. When we get to something like Solera, Solera rum, which I believe is the Centenario Solera, right? Yes, it is. So this would list, let's say, 25 years. That would be, in this case, the oldest rum because it's imported. Whereas if we did this in the United States, we'd have to list the youngest rum. Then you have flavored rums. For instance, here's our flavored rum. This is a grilled pineapple rum. It was made with 100% fresh pineapples, real pineapples, not a flavor additive. Like, let's say, if you went and bought a Bacardi orange. Just for your own sake, like take a step back and think about it. Could they produce enough oranges really for that product to be distributed worldwide? I don't think so. And surely not the amount of flavors that they have. And then you think, well, Pinnacle's doing the same thing, and all, you know, Stoli's doing the same thing, and Smirnoff's doing, where's all this produce coming from? It's not, you know, it's all coming from a lab. But that falls into flavored. You have your spiced rums, which is just with different spices, botanicals, whatever the case may be. And then you have your overproof. And overproof is something that's, a lot of that's coming from the islands. You know, people in the islands use it for like health benefits too. Like instead of taking medicine to clear up your sinuses, they might rub some overproof on their neck or behind their ears. I know that sounds crazy, but people love overproof. some common brands to take a look at. Appleton in Jamaica, Bacardi in Puerto Rico. Bacardi is the largest distiller in the world, just so you know. Captain Morgan, it says Puerto Rico. Captain Morgan is in Virgin Islands. The Diageo owns Captain Morgan. And the U.S. government actually built a distillery in the U.S. Virgin Islands on a grant, $165 million grant, for Diageo to produce Captain Morgan. In fact, that's why it has its own category of U.S. Virgin Islands rum. We just made a product for one of our clients, and I had to import rum from their distillery, and that's literally what it said. It said it came from, and where it says distillery on my form, it just said U.S. Virgin Islands, which is kind of cool. Gosling's in Bermuda, Mount Gay in Barbados, Myers in Jamaica, Sailor Jerry's is U.S. Virgin Islands. If I'm not mistaken, Sailor Jerry's is coming from the same place as Captain Morgan. Ten Cane and then Zacapa. So cachaca versus rum. I would debate this first line, but it says that cachaca is not a style of rum. I would say it's Brazilian rum. That's what Joe was calling it earlier. Cachaca is made from sugarcane juice, like an agricole. Cachaca has to be from Brazil. It's like tequila coming from Mexico. It also has specific rules around how it's aged and the types of wood it can be aged in and where the wood has to come from and all these sorts of things. A lot of the really high-end cachacas come from, were aged in woods that are very rare. Good or bad, I can't really say, because I've tasted some cachaças that to me tasted like perfume, and it definitely came from the wood, not from the spirit. But at the same time, you know, someone might say the same about like a high-end whiskey if they weren't, you know, if they didn't have that kind of palate.
There are distilleries like arguing with the Brazilian government because, like Avi is saying, they're using woods from the rainforest. They're just chopping down. So they have the real difference that I, other than it's Brazilian rum, that they use a ton of different, so they have walnut, all these, you know, endangered species of wood. So right now, the big distilleries like LeBlanc, the big guys, are fighting with the Brazilian government because they're going into the rainforest and chopping down, like, the last tree of this kind of species because, like, we need to put booze in that tree, which another reason why I hate this.
Like rum, there's different types. I don't know, artisanal? I guess they're separating it out based on the pot still type. Again, I think cachaca is an acquired taste, and you'll see that with the blonde. It must be aged in wood, and as it says here, there's a lot of native woods, very kind of rare woods that they use to make their cachacas. Does anyone have a question about cachaca? Before we get to rum tasting, something really cool I want to do. At least I think it's cool, but I'm a little nerdy. So we talk about something called Solera. Are you guys familiar with Solera, what that means? Typically, I would have a slide with a pyramid. But imagine a pyramid of barrels where the top rum or the top barrel is freshly produced rum, and the bottom barrel is, let's say, a blend of all like the oldest rums you've made. And essentially, when you go to harvest, let's say we want to bottle three barrels, four barrels, whatever the case may be. Let's say the bottom of your triangle is eight barrels wide. You go to the eight barrels, you take out half a barrel from each, so you've made four barrels. Then you go to the row above it, you fill the rows below it with the row above it, and you keep trickling down rum through the triangle until you have to put brand new rum into the top of it. It's kind of like a sourdough in that it creates like a balanced rum over a long period of time, and it really makes a complex flavor because you have, you know, rum added to it every year or whatever your schedule is. So
50 years down the road, you saw trace elements of that first rum you have to put in.
So what we did is after our lecture last time, I went and I got us a little barrel. This holds two bottles. We swelled it before we came here. I actually popped off one of the rings because the wood absorbed so much liquid. And what we're going to do is we're going to pour in white rum, Fuego. It's already at 40%, so it's a little bit different than if you were doing it at the distillery at a higher proof. But to keep it legal, we have to do it out of the bottle. And we're going to set this in the wine vault so that every semester, when we come back, we can take out half the barrel, we can look at the color, taste it, how it's changed over the approximately 6 months, and then fill it up with new white rum. And over the years, this is going to become a very delicious barrel, in my opinion.
So if you want to fail this class a few times and keep redoing it,
so if you don't want to come up here and pour the rum into the barrel, anyone? And just stay off to the side because I'm recording over here. So. Yep, the whole bottle fits two bottles. So what we'll do is every time we come back, we'll empty it. We'll take pictures of the color so I can make a slide that shows, you know, how it progressed and if any evaporated into what's called the angel share, that kind of thing. What's really cool about barrels, you won't see it happen here because there's not enough alcohol in the air, but there's actually a black mold that grows in barrel storage areas because it eats the vapors of alcohol. Totally harmless to humans, but if you go, like, even in wine cellars, I was out in Napa in September, and, like, some of the coolest places to go were, like, the wine caves. And you go into the wine caves, and they're full of, like, this growth on the walls. So even the barrels in our distillery these days, like, on the outside, you can see it's starting to form. It starts with the wood first. So it's starting on our barrels, but then it's going to head to our ceiling next, I have a feeling. So in 6 months' time, we'll see what happens to it. Now, a smaller barrel has more surface area ratio because there's less liquid. So that should age pretty quickly in there. As opposed to, let's say, if you had a 53-gallon barrel, it might take a year to get to the same place. But the only thing you're not getting is that this doesn't concentrate the flavor as much. You just get the wood flavor. It doesn't concentrate the flavors in the rum itself. So with that, I'm going to pass it off to Joey and take you guys for the tasting.
So one thing I've learned from obviously going to Rosen and being in front of, you know, bar, being a bartender, being a server, is that these flavors are so opinionated. I've had rum judges come up to me and, you know, I kind of joke about it, but you know, I've had guys come up, this tastes like papyrus. Fuck this papyrus. But in a good way. I'm like, what? Get the fuck out of here. Like, what are you talking about? This tastes like papyrus. So one thing I've learned, we were on Booze Traveler and he really, like, really emphasized this, you know, you got to sell the experience of something, right? What does this make you feel? Not what this is. We can all say this tastes like lemon and notes of pepper and all this. We can go on for days. And that you really learn. I think wine's a good way to learn that. Alcohol is kind of hard, kind of get punched in the face. So I would say take a sip first when you taste, smell it, taste it, then taste it again. You know, alcohol is 40% alcohol. It's poison. Your body does not want you to drink this stuff. So you got to kind of warm your palate up to that. But again, explain like an experience. So I'm going to let you guys explain it. So like, let's say this, we'll start with the gin, right? This gin tastes so refreshing, like I'm driving through the hills of North Carolina. What? But seriously, that you can sell that to a table, right? Sell them experience. So let's start with Fuego, the first one. So smell it, taste it.
Which is number four, yeah?
Number four. Yeah, we don't want to taste the vodka.
Well, and you might want to put it up next to the Bacardi sample so you can see the difference between something that's filtered, like highly filtered. And in fact, if you read the bottle, they're like the pioneers of filtering versus our rum, which is a straight pot still rum, no filter.
The Jamaican.
We're not offended, by the way, if you don't like it.
Yeah,
so
not
don't,
at all.
You know, feel free to voice your opinion. But it's just a totally different style product than a Bacardi Superior.
Had a Jamaican guy told me body odor, but in a good way. He was explaining there's a Jamaican word called hogo, which means like funk. So what do you guys taste?
Good fat, bad fat, avocados.
Yeah. It's like an avocado. I like that.
All right, let's move on to the next one. Florida Cana. So again, I have a little pet peeve about these guys too. So these guys are kill about 3 people a day at their distillery. Of chronic kidney failure. The pesticides they use on the sugar cane is not too good. So if you guys want to taste that, that's up to you. But I do like the flavor rum. It is a, like it says, a medium-bodied rum, very mild, doesn't have too much going on, makes great simple rum cocktails. Someone want to explain that for me? Anyone?
It smells like cleaning products.
Cleaning products? Yeah, it does taste like Pine Sol.
This one, is that real? It's $15.
Yeah.
How's that possible?
Anyone? Come on.
Need some more.
Sell me the experience.
That's what I like about the molasses rums. I don't really like, what's the next one? That's not Clément. Clément is one of the later ones. You'll see it's a little different. They make it's an agricole rum. So like the cachaca is fresh pressed cane juice, fermented, distilled. And the difference between cane is crazy. We have a buddy in Haiti that has a farm, and he makes agricole rum, and they call it Clarin in Haiti, and it tastes like a molasses based rum. Like it, if you told me it was fresh fish, I bet you $1 million it wasn't. But it is, you know, so the difference in distillation, how clean it is, if you make it like Bacardi does and you make vodka, it's going to take all the flavor away. Something like Haiti, they're like using like boilers and like barely taking any alcohol off because they're just trying to get every bit they can. You get these big, deep, bold flavors. So this is something similar to like an aged Bacardi, very clean rum, butterscotch from the barrels. They probably add caramel to it as well.
I would say so.
Next one. So Avi states that this is going to be the rum of 2017 or black rums. Black rums don't necessarily...
Mark my word.
Yeah. Black rums don't necessarily have to be aged. They can be flavored. They can be not flavored. But what it is, it starts off as a rum, and then you add like burnt sugar or molasses to it. We make a Harambe Fuego, which is a black banana rum. I distill it like a gin. I put bananas and clove and cinnamon and vanilla and cocoa nibs in the still. I distill that so you get all the botanical flavors like a gin. Then what we do is we add our molasses back. And we talked about our molasses is super clean. There's no ash. So basically, it's darker than this, but it has all those flavors of the molasses. So what do you taste? What do you smell? Pepper? Was it what?
Caramel? Yeah.
Maybe.
What?
Maybe.
Vanilla extract? There's probably vanilla extract in here for sure. I feel like this is one of those foo-foo drinks I get from Tom Cruise. Like, you float a little of that out, he'd float to you and like throw it at you and you catch him in your cocktail. One of those kind of drinks.
Hold on. Dark and Stormy. There's a couple rum cocktails out there. What's the other one? The Pusser's Rum?
Painkiller.
Painkiller. There's a couple cocktails out there that have to be made with certain brands. So Dark and Stormy is trademarked. Dark and Stormies are only Gosling's Dark Rum and Ginger Beer. So.
And make sure that you use the Bermudan or Jamaican style ginger beer. Gosling's do a ginger beer as well. They don't actually make it. It's made in Massachusetts for them. But you want that style of ginger
beer.
You don't want the American clear ginger beer which doesn't taste, not going to taste right in the Dark and Stormy.
You need that to cut the acidity and the sweetness of the ginger beer. Those big molasses, those caramel flavors that make up a dark rum really cut through that. That's what the Harambe Fuego. That's why we did it. It's a really rum to float on that Mai Tai. It's gonna be it. So Kraken Black. This is another cool one. So this is same style except you'll take like a spiced rum and then make it black. Again, the black can be flavorful. We've had rums, like we know these guys, they got Flipper on their bottle. They literally just add like burnt sugar to their product and it doesn't taste like anything. So this one, way more vanilla extract, right?
So what do you guys think, because this kind of stuff interests me. What do you think when someone advertises that there's 11 secret spices? Like, how do you feel about that? Well, sure, but like, is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? Do you feel like they're making it up? Yeah, me too. Now, we try and do everything with transparency. There's like a big kind of rift in the rum community where, again, like I was saying before, like the corporate side tries to push the boundaries of what they're allowed to do with labeling and how you word things, where they come out with a product that's worded one way for the initial release of the product, and they change what goes into the bottle without really changing the way the label looks. These things take place all the time, so just curious. Something to pay attention to.
Yeah, yeah. So I was going to say, it's like my grandma spiked my eggnog when I was like 3.
Yeah.
Right? My bob, my special baba.
That explains
it all. Right? Yeah, right? Mm, all makes sense now.
Guys, can I interrupt you a moment? If you could take your Fuego glass, which is number 4, dump out anything that's left in it.
Drink it.
Or drink it. But preferably dump it out. Okay, and put the glass at the end of your set on the all the way on the right hand side of the top, because JJ is going to pour the Fuego grilled pineapple rum. Okay.
Yeah, buddy. So that one like smells like my grandma just got home from the farmer's market with like some fresh pineapples. She's making pineapple upside down cake, and then it tastes like my grandpa spilled bourbon on it. So the next one is the Agricole I was talking about. So again, it's like brandy, right? You press the grapes, you ferment the grapes, you distill the grapes, you have brandy. Same thing with rum agricole. You press the sugar cane, you ferment the sugar cane, you distill the sugar cane, you have agricole rum. Probably considered one of the pure rums. I've seen all the rum judges like go nuts over this. All the like rum aficionados, they're all about the agricole from the... I'm not about it. I think it's a little grassy. It's a little vegetal. I like the bigger, bolder Jamaican-style molasses. It has those funk to it. It has that hogo, whatever that means.
Something to note, just you know, from an observation standpoint, like I mentioned, that this is governed like the French wines. So you see the labels almost similar to what you'd find on like a French wine, right? They have a picture of the estate or the chateau on it, and it's a very plain label other than that.
So what do you think? Not as sweet, right? Like it? Yeah. Very clean.
This rum, by the way, retails for $45 a bottle.
Wine?
Yeah.
Yeah. So they use like French oak barrels a lot too, because it's a French island. So
La Mousson barrels? I've never heard of that. What was that? So Fuego's sold in our distillery and retail for 45?
35.
It's 35 in our shop, but
45 at Total Wine.
Yeah, Total Wine maybe
screwed us over.
Yeah, that's another class, but when you start to deal with like how liquor makes its way from our still to your house, it gets all messed up. French oak barrels. Is that a producer of them? Or is it just a type of French oak? It's an area. Okay, that makes more sense. And then recharred bourbon casks, which would have meant this is a blend of French oak and American oak. Ready for the next one?
Yeah. So this is very delicious. Probably my third favorite in this list, right? Two of us. Third favorite in this list. This is a Solera. So the 25 year again refers to the bottom of the barrel. Those bottom level of barrels, there's some rum in there that was in 20. There was 25 years ago, right? But they're blended down. I personally love this method. I can't do it yet because I don't have enough barrels. But when I really like it for consistency purposes. You're allowed. You can blend a lot. Yeah, it's a good picture so you can see. But you just take a little bit. Yes. You see it, take a little bit, add a little bit, take a little bit, add a little bit. You really develop these really cool flavors because I wish I had some single barrel to show you of my rum, but I take my white rum and I put it in barrels. I don't do anything different to it because I wanted people to be able to taste the white rum and then taste the rum as it progresses to pineapple, to the aged stuff, to whatever it's doing. I wanted people to taste the base spirit. So it's really cool to show people the different levels, but once you have the Solera, you're able to blend a ton of different flavors. So you have those vegetal notes, those grassy notes, those shortbread notes from the Fuego, and then when you have the aged rum, you get the vanilla, the caramel, the butterscotch, the toffee, and maybe a little bit of tropical fruit notes.
Anyone have any questions about Solera?
What does it taste like? Sweet.
Hilarious. How many of you have done the Exploring Wines class? Number of you. Do you remember Sherry? How's Sherry made in Spain? Yeah, Solera system, same way.
Good. That rum, anyone want to guess the price on that per bottle? $60 a bottle.
Yeah. Very. I like making like stuff with that. I like making old fashions, Manhattans. I really like taking whiskey cocktails with the older rums, the older aged rums, especially like the older Jamaican rums are really woody, like a bourbon. And taking those old school Manhattan sidecars, all those old school whiskey apothecary cocktails, and introducing rum to them. I think rum, you know, we all want to. The sweet stuff's awesome. Like, I'm not going to diss it. Mai Tais are great. Daiquiris are great. But, like, sometimes you need a more refined cocktail, something a little more spirit forward. And rum can really stand up to those cocktails all through the board.
What was that? 60 for the Centenario, yeah.
Le Blanc. What do you guys smell?
So this is cachaca.
Yep.
They make a caipirinha?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's your tip. That's your like your standard cocktail with cachaca.
That is like the Brazilian cocktail. So the difference between a daiquiri and a caipirinha, Avi loves them, and Avi does a great job. I think it's a lot of work because you got to muddle them. But the difference, you're using daiquiri is one part lime juice, one part simple syrup, two parts rum. And that's how I judge rum. Like, if I'm going to make a cocktail, I want to judge it that way. So you're making it with this. You have the one part lime juice, two parts rum, one part simple syrup. You can switch it out. It's really good. For the caipirinha, you muddle it. So you take the lime chunks, and you're getting those lime oils while you're muddling it, and you don't use as much sugar. But that's literally the only two. You muddle the limes, you don't muddle limes. It's the only difference between daiquiri and caipirinha.
Anyone want to say what it tastes like to them?
I think some of the cassava, even when we had even those woods, there's like this sour note that I really comes through. And she just said it tastes like olives.
Yeah.
It smells like olives.
There's this like sour note, and I think that comes from, like we talked about earlier, we would love to get fresh pressed cane juice, but as soon as you press cane juice, it ferments. So if you're not careful, you don't pitch the right yeast to it or control the bacteria level in it, you're gonna get some funky stuff going on really easy.
Your own cocktail. Oh no, Fuego Pineapple. So Le Blanc, $28 a bottle. And then you have one more tasting, that's the grilled pineapple. If there's no slide for it, and then we'll get on to it.
So the grilled pineapple, we hooked up with this guy in Vero Beach. He has 10 acres. He has old family farm. Back in the day, our first commercial crop were pineapples.
In Florida.
In Florida. But Florida takes, pineapple takes about this much land and 13 months to produce one pineapple. Think about how many oranges you can grow on this much land. He took all the pineapples up. So this guy has an old citrus farm. He took all his stuff down, about 10 acres, and he plants Florida-grown pineapples. And pineapples grown on the plant are like mind-blowing. They're super sweet, hardly any acidity. They're super tender. So what we did, we got all ripe. We filled Avi's Scion. We should have bottled that smell because it was amazing. Filled this Scion, sliced the pineapples, dusted them in cinnamon sugar, a little bit of nutmeg is my secret ingredient. We grilled them, got a nice caramel char on them. Soaked them in rum for 3 months, and then blended it with barrel-aged rum to really enforce the rum. As you see, you get like a nice warm pineapple smell, but the taste, still rum. Definitely not mistaken for rum. What was that? Cinnamon comes through as well. Nice warming factor.
And your cocktail.
Cocktail. So we got a Mai Tai for you. These are real good. Again, these are one of those classic tiki cocktails. This is when it first originated. Orgeat's really cool. It's like an almond orange liqueur. Our friend makes it with pistachios. You can make your own at home, or you can buy. It's actually kind of hard to find. They've been coming. The tiki. What happened with tiki is we started with all these fresh juices, right? Don the Beachcomber came in. He's juicing limes and guava and pineapple and juicing all these stuff. And he blew up tiki, right, in the 60s, 70s. It blows up. And in the 80s, you know, people are like, oh, let's make tiki. And they're using canned pineapple juice and syrups and all these nasty bottled lime juice. And it, like, destroyed the tiki movement. Now, as we're starting to get in, like, you know, as the consumer, we want fresh juices and fresh syrups and different stuff. The tiki movement's coming back because we're starting to use all these fresh juices, really making balanced cocktails, and the Mai Tai is at the front of that. You know, I'm a big believer in taking these templates and switching stuff out, you know, whether it be lemon juice for lime juice, making a pistachio orgeat, infusing the orgeat with something you want. Instead of a rock candy syrup, maybe making a ginger simple syrup. Is there a daiquiri slide or
no? No.
So a daiquiri, this is a real fun one. I get, you guys are doing a... with your end of semester project at Creative Bar. So daiquiri is a real simple one that you can really play with. So it's one part simple syrup, one part fresh squeezed lime juice, two parts rum. I make a watermelon one that I substitute a little bit of lime juice or watermelon juice, and the simple syrup, I'll take like old parsley stems that I'm done using the parsley for. I'll take the parsley stems and soak that in the simple syrup for an hour, make a parsley simple syrup, and use that to make a watermelon daiquiri, and it tastes like a watermelon Jolly Rancher with fuego. Absolutely amazing. Yeah, Wes.
What is the third ingredient?
Cointreau?
Yeah.
Cointreau, so it's, have you heard of Grand Marnier?
Yeah.
So it's pretty much the same thing. It's an orange liqueur.
Right.
I believe the Cointreau is at 40% as well. Triple Sec is that's they use that a lot. That's only 5%. So that really, I believe it's 40%.
All right.
And the other thing to mention on here is the rock candy syrup. It's no different than sugar syrup, just made 2-to-1. Way thicker. It adds more of like a velvety texture to the cocktail itself when you shake it up. That can make or break a cocktail if you don't use the right thickness of your simple syrup, depending
on
what it
is. This is the Cointreau bottle. So it's a liqueur. It's 40% ABV.
That's why a lot of, again, the triple sec was popular, again, because it's cheap to make. It's only 5%. They had 5% out more to make it stable, if anything, right? You're having a sweet liquid. Got to stabilize somehow. Just throw some booze in there. I don't like using triple. I'd rather use, like, Grand Marnier or Cointreau for something if you want that. Triple sec also has a little orange flavor to it as well.
I'm going to show those two videos real quick, and then because we have 15
yeah,
minutes.
Yeah, the other thing I also want you to tell them about is because I think these guys are marketing geniuses as well. And I told you they were from Fort Lauderdale's oldest distillery, so I need you to tell them that story as well. It's on their label as well. Yeah.
Sure, I'll get to that in 1 second. Two videos real quick just to wrap this up and sum up all the stuff I didn't mention. And these videos you can find, they're on liquor.com, or just go into YouTube and type in liquor.com rum, and it'll come up. But it essentially tells you everything you need to know in 2 minutes. So here we go. Okay, so that's all I have for the rum presentation. Does anyone have any questions? Talk about rum, you can ask us questions about what we do, whatever you want. So our rum, in terms of liquor stores, we're in Total Wine and ABC. Total Wine, we're not in as far north as Orlando, but I believe ABC, we might have a location up here. Fort Myers, no. We're mostly East Coast and like going up that way. When you start getting out to like Fort Myers in that area, you're going to find more of like your Wicked Dolphin from Cape Coral. Okay, so you have your Wicked Dolphin from there, and then you also have Siesta Key from Drum Circle Distilling. Sarasota. Yeah, come visit. And then we can show you how it's made. We have other stuff that you can taste at the distillery. So we're literally right next to Fort Lauderdale Airport. So if you're familiar with the area, if you get on US 1 North when you're leaving the airport, you'll go over 595. And then immediately on your right-hand side is our building.
Are you guys partnered with the distributor?
So we use a local distributor down in South Florida. The distribution market's really kind of divided into two models. You have your distributors that buy inventory, and then they have sales reps that go and sell it. And you have the other half, which is more like a consignment model, where you make a deal with your distributor, and you kind of go out and build your sales network, and they facilitate transportation, paperwork, taxes, and all that stuff, but they're not really helping out too much. We're kind of in that second bucket. It's really tough to get a distributor to invest in your product, which is essentially when they're buying inventory. I'd like to say we're always on the verge of having that type of distributor. It's the best I can really tell you. Anyone else? Has anyone else tried the moonshine? Just curious. Camera's facing this way, so don't worry. No, have you ever tried making moonshine? Okay. Have you ever tried moonshine? Okay, interesting.
Did you have your sign yet? Your road sign yet?
No. So we've been operating literally from the beginning with no signage whatsoever. It's one of those things that people super always yell at me about, but I'm not, like, my background's in electrical engineering. I'm not, hospitality stuff falls to the wayside for me. That's why Joe's my compliment. But since 2014, we've been operating with no signage on our business, which is interesting.
So unlike the breweries who are allowed to have a bar and a restaurant and serve, like, drinks, we are not legally allowed to. We have a limit on how many bottles we can sell. We cannot sell cocktails at all. So we really didn't focus on that part, on the on-premise part, right? We're more of a production facility. So we do tours when people come. We just got news that law might change in April or in May. And that happens, and then game on. We'll have like a bar and a restaurant and all of that.
Yeah, this round of legislation in the state calls for things like us being able to sell cocktails, might open our ability to ship. Essentially, we'd be allowed to operate like any other vendor that has a regular liquor license, whether it's on-premise or off-premise, which for us, you know, changes the game because we don't have to focus on making sure restaurants are selling our product. We can kind of run our own operation, self-sustain, fully profitable, just off of a bar on our own site, and then from there worry about what the rest of the market thinks about it.
And if you look at their bottle, it does say on it Fort Lauderdale's oldest distillery, which was founded when?
In 2014.
2014, but it is indeed Fort Lauderdale's oldest distillery because it's Fort Lauderdale's first distillery, which I think is pretty clever.
We're still the only. Still the only, surprisingly enough.
Yeah,
I think if the laws do change in April, you'll see a humongous explosion. Is anyone from Tampa? Like, there's tons of distilleries in Tampa. Like, that's like the new wave out there. But we're still kind of by ourselves in South Florida. So,
anyone want to make a cocktail?
Yeah.
One, two. I got six glasses.